Antonio Vargas of the Washington Post.
Jose Antonio Vargas is a Pulitzer Prize-winning journalist.
I lived the American dream, building a successful career as a journalist. But I was living a lie.
I'm going to tell you something that I haven't told a lot of people. I'm actually an undocumented immigrant. Immigration is stories, so here's my story. My grandparents legally immigrated from the Philippines in the mid-1980s. My grandfather decided that he was gonna get his grandson to come to America.
One morning, my suitcase was packed. I was 12. It's been 18 years since I've seen my mother.
So I'm launching a whole campaign about what it means to be an American and the fact that I am an American. There are 11 million undocumented people in this country.
In 2010, undocumented people paid $11.2 billion in state and local taxes.
My name is Erika Andiola. I'm from Colombia.
From Nigeria.
From Brazil.
I'm an undocumented immigrant from Germany.
We mow your lawn. We work at your houses. Maybe we're your doctors. Maybe we're nurses. We're not who you think we are.
People who have come here illegally should not be citizens of the United States.
So what happens in Iowa if you discover as a cop that somebody is an undocumented person?
I'm looking for freedom, looking for freedom.
A major blow for immigration reform. Today, the Senate voted against the DREAM Act.
I'm a conservative and I'm a hardcore Republican, but I don't agree with them on this.
You're an illegal alien.
No, I'm an undocumented immigrant.
No, you're an illegal.
No, wait, no, actually, this
I
is...
I think I've broken a law just having you in my studio.
No, this is...
Who is really the Americans? I would say people came here to do good for this country.
We dream of a path to citizenship. We dream of contributing to the country we call our home. I have this fantasy that I get a green card and I fly. And that my mother would be there waiting for me.
I'm looking for freedom.
Judith Vecchione. She works at WGBH, Boston's public television, where she has contributed to major documentary series, including Nova, American Experience, and Frontline. She won an Emmy for Vietnam, a television history and series senior producer for the award-winning Eyes on the Prize. She has been executive producer for several national PBS series, including America's, De Gaulle, and France, and The Blues, and specials such as Eleanor Roosevelt, Young and Restless in China, and The Longoria Affair. In 2012, she presented Medal Quest, American Athletes and Paralympic Games, PBS's first digital original series for general audiences. She followed that up in February 2014 with Ice Warriors, a film on the U.S. sled hockey team preparing for the 2014 Winter Paralympics Games in Sochi, Russia. And a new version of the film with footage from the exciting Sochi Games will be released as a documentary feature in November 2014. Ms. Vecchione has won multiple other awards, including the Peabody Award, Polk Award, Davy Award, Cine Golden Eagle, Christopher Award, and Chicago Film Festival Award, among others. She is also Senior Editorial Advisor for the World Channel, and please join me in welcoming Judith Vecchione and our panel, whom she'll introduce. Moderate this panel of distinguished speakers. The first person is Jose Antonio Vargas, directly to my right. Intimate and courageous film. It really is quite wonderful, and thank you, and we're looking forward to sharing it with this audience live. Also with us is, next, is Eva Millona, who is executive director of the Massachusetts Immigrant and Refugee Advocacy Coalition called MIRA. She's also co-chair of the National Partnership for New Americans, the lead national organization that focuses on immigration integration. And she is an immigrant herself from Albania. So she is also co-chair of the Governor's Advisory Council on Refugees and Immigrants, serves on the U.S. Commission on Civil Rights, and among her many awards is the U.S. Citizenship and Immigration Services Outstanding American by Choice Award. Great title, that is. Also with us, far end of the panel, is Aviva Chomsky, Professor of History and Coordinator of Latin American, Latino, and Caribbean Studies at Salem State University here in Massachusetts. Her books include Undocumented, which I think we have a copy of. I think it may be available if you're interested. A book called Linked Labor Histories, New England, Columbia, and the Making of a Global Working Class. And a book provocatively titled, They Take Our Jobs, and 20 Other Myths About Immigration. She's been active in Latin American solidarity and immigrants' rights movements for a long time. So, let's start with you, Jose, and thank you so much, as I said, for this tremendous, courageous program, which will have its national premiere this weekend. Is that correct?
Yes.
On CNN.
Yes.
On CNN. So you finished it fairly recently, but let me ask you, has anything changed for you since you finished it?
No. I got a therapist. And you know, this wonderful, wonderful woman, we had an event, when was that?
A couple years ago,
she took me out for coffee, and then I told her what I was about to do. And at that point, I hadn't quite decided yet whether I was going to send a crew to the Philippines to film my mom. And, because you know, originally I wasn't going to even film at all. And then once I made that decision, mental health and like the psychology of all of this is something we rarely ever discuss. If you have friends in New York City tomorrow, Psychology Today and CNN are actually hosting a screening tomorrow night in the Time Warner Center for free. Talk about psychology, mental health issues that relates to immigration, and we're going to show them.
That's my turn.
Just plug on that. Just go to documentedthefilm.com. Sorry, I'm just plugging that. Documentedthefilm.com. So, I got a therapist. I am still undocumented, so we're waiting for. I have 16 lawyers. I mean, I think one thing that I wanted to say in the film that I ended up taking out because it seemed too obvious is to say that I'm the most privileged undocumented immigrant ever. Look, now some people get deported, they went away to make the film.
I think that was part of the impetus for the question. Here you are, you're right out there, and they're not taking you.
And, you know, I have
I love that you asked, you know, what are you going to do with me? But over and over.
But I think actually for us, when this airs on CNN, can you imagine CNN, the same network that gave a platform for years for new jobs, the same network is going to air this film on primetime television twice on Sunday night and then encore again on July 5th. So we have a week during July 4th weekend, my favorite American holiday, to ask this question of what do you want to do with me, what do you want to do with us, and how do you define America? So we were very implicit in trying to, very deliberate in trying to do that. So nothing has changed. My lawyers seem to think that that marrying a man, you don't want to appeal, might be a solution, but you don't know. But first, I'm going to be aware where I'm actually dating.
I was going to say,
so, you know, like, what's the time?
And actually, it was one of the things that I thought about in the film was how alone you are in it.
You know, I didn't really realize that until I have this, I mean, let's talk about privilege, right? Like, to see yourself unfold and to get to know yourself and how broken you are on film. That was, for me, like the most jarring. Ever since I was a kid, you know, I was a dreamer before there was a dream act. So ever since I was a kid, once I found out that I was this illegal faggot in America, I made a decision that this country wasn't going to break. That I was going to be so successful, whatever that meant, that you couldn't deny me anything. But that's a delusional thing to think. And then here I was, I had everything I ever wanted. I had the job, I had everything I wanted. And I was miserable. I never talk about openly about depression. So, I mean, for me, this film has been very cathartic. And the big change is I've gotten to know my mother, and she and I have connected a lot better. That's beautiful.
Let me bring in the other panelists. This is one person's story. This is what we've been watching. And you can see throughout that the opponents of immigration reform are trying to make him seem unusual, exceptional, different. Is that true? Or does your research, your understanding support how much he's representing other people's experience?
Yep.
To either of you, actually, without me.
One of the things that I was really glad you emphasized in the film that makes your story the same as the story of most undocumented immigrants is that when people ask the question, well, why don't you just fix your papers? Why don't you just become legal? That people do not understand, and I think you showed it really clearly in the film, there is no path. There is no line to stand in. There's nothing you can do to fix your papers. And I actually observed this happening in the Massachusetts state legislature a few years ago. When some undocumented students were testifying for the a bill for in-state tuition in Massachusetts, and they stated openly that they were undocumented, and when they finished giving their testimony, one of the legislators said, well, to one of the young women, so what's your status now? She even talked about how she was brought here by her parents. And she said, well, I just told you I'm undocumented. And he said, well, why don't you do anything to fix your status? And the student who was sitting next to me, one of my students from Salem State, who is a citizen, said, these are the legislators. Like, aren't they supposed to know what the law is? So that was an area where I was watching and thinking, you know, you're speaking for pretty much everybody who's undocumented when you showed that.
Well, let me first say thank you so much, Jose, for sharing your story and the intimate story. I mean, this is one of the 11 million people's story, but it's told in an exceptional way. So I can't thank you enough for sharing it with us and for producing this wonderful, touching, and courageous documentary that I hope will make the impact that you really hope to make. And as I was, you know, watching it, I was thinking about our conversation two years ago. It was 18 years, you said 18 years I haven't seen my mom, and we had really this very emotional conversation. So at a personal level, I am so glad that you're talking to your mom, that the love is open and all of us know how precious that is. But as you saw, I mean, it is told, the story is told in a very exceptional way, but this is the story of 11 million. Each and every one has a story. And you may not be as media working as this, you know, the story of this exceptional young man, but everybody has a story to tell. So going back to your point, I mean, we've been fighting hard for the in-state tuition in the state of Massachusetts. We have been fighting hard for the Dream Act to pass at the national level. And I hope the members of our legislature who voted no and sent the bill to study can see this movie and really see the impact. I mean, this is the story of all young people who were brought here. The decision was made for Jose. He had no say. He found out when he was at a point that he needed to make decisions. So I hope that this will make the impact and people will really learn that we are a nation of immigrants. And at some point, grandparents and great-grandparents came to this country. And I'm the fourth generation of four naturalized citizens. You know, my parents were separated because of the Cold War with their parents. So the story of immigration is a story about separation of families. And I think we, as the most powerful country in the world, can do better and fix the immigration system to really fix the 11 million stories.
I do want to say that we're going to welcome questions from you as well.
So I've been filming for 3 years. There's about 120 hours of footage. Before I even filmed anything, my original idea for this film was, anybody here seen Inside Job by Charles Ferguson?
Yes.
It's a wonderful kind of essay. It's what we call an essay film that basically lays out an argument and then tells you how we got to the financial mess that we got. Mm-hmm. Right? It's a fantastic argument. So I was going to do that, and I had a student. I taught a class at Georgetown University for a semester. So I had a student who I used to teach who's now at C-SPAN. So I had him take 5 hours of footage of politicians talking about immigration reform. And then I was watching it, and I'm like, oh God, this is so boring. Like, it just wasn't, you know, it just, it's like, you know, I love broccoli, but broccoli's not the second case of eating broccoli. It's like, do I really want to hear all these anti-immigrant people? Do I really want to make a film that's going to over-politicize an already politicized issue? So then I scrapped that idea. Then I'm like, Waiting for Superman meets the Dream Act. Waiting for Superman is not a perfect film, but it's kind of a perfect example of an issue film. So I come out, so I prepare my coming out, and then the film introduces you to five other undocumented young people. The undocumented Nigerian, the undocumented German, the undocumented Mexican in Alabama. Basically the kids in the cover of Time magazine. Are people here from SIM? There they are. So the SIM, wonderful SIM students actually work on the cover with me. Is that right?
Yeah.
Hey, what's up? The whole film would have told the story of these four dreamers and then ended in the cover of Time magazine, and then that's it. No mother, no grandmother in rollers. It's frankly, so I'm really uncomfortable, as you probably can tell, with this whole privilege question, right? I carry a certain amount of survivor guilt, and the last thing I wanted was to, especially considering we're having, you know, within the dreamers, the undocumented youth, there's a lot of conversations about the exceptional dreamer, right? Like the valedictorian, doctor, lawyer, Harvard, Ivy League, want to go to. Guess what? Most people aren't like that. And by the way, I can barely pass chemistry. So like, I wasn't that at all. And I was afraid that if I made a film about myself, it was going to become this like, oh my God, he's so successful, whatever. And then I thought, if I'm going to connect with people, I need to give people what is most painful to me. And that's, of course, my mom. But I didn't want to do that because I hardly could deal with it myself, much less put it on film to like share with the rest of the public. But now that we've done about 30 screenings, particularly targeting, you know, Republicans and conservatives, I know that I've done the right film. Because for us at Define American, I know that when you go home, you will go to defineamerican.com. To us, culture is politics. Our political system is such in a standstill that unless we change the culture in which people think of this issue, we're not going to change the politics. Take same-sex marriage. Can you, 10 years ago, President Bush gets re-elected on the back of opposition to same-sex marriage. Here we are 10 years later, same-sex marriage is all but inevitable. Mm-hmm. What happened in 10 years? Will and Grace, Ellen DeGeneres, Bravo, all these young people coming out, gay straight alliances, that's what happened. Culture shift before politics shift. So on immigration, that's what we're trying to do. The last point I want to make, we recently had a screening in Miami because the film has been traveling across the country. And you know that scene in Spanish, that beautiful scene in Spanish? So many of those women in that scene came to one of the screenings. And one of the women stood up at the end during a Q&A like this, and she said, Jose, I'm really glad that you included the fact that you were mad at your mom, that you were angry at your mom. Because my son was very angry with me for bringing us here. And the son was sitting like two, six, audience up and looks at the mom and publicly apologizes to the mom. So I believe that stories and that art liberate people. As you all well know, that we are fighting for more than pieces of papers here. We're fighting for dignity. That's what we're fighting for. We're fighting for our stories to be heard and for us to be treated as the complex human beings that we are. Right. And so for me, that's the goal of this film. That's the goal, that's the kind of conversation that we're hoping to elevate.
I have a ton of new questions that I could ask, but I don't want to hog the time. Are there people who would like to raise a hand, get a microphone, hand it to them, or shall I keep asking?
Do you mind if I ask a question for the people?
Perhaps.
I'm such a journalist. Okay. So, we are in Massachusetts. You know, the Kennedy family. I keep an underlying copy of The Nation of Immigrants with President Kennedy, with the foreword by Ted Kennedy. So we are in Massachusetts that doesn't have driver's licenses, that doesn't have in-state tuition, right? The same Massachusetts that doesn't have, tomorrow, New York City is gonna pass a municipal ID bill that would grant municipal IDs to 500,000 undocumented New Yorkers. Mm-hmm. So where does Boston get a job?
Well, I think there is somebody there from the mayor's office, but I think we have. Hope, and we have a very progressive mayor who has made it very public that Boston is a welcoming city. He has said that he will revamp the office of the Bostonian, meaning expand the office that, you know, was created for the first time. So Boston really took the lead in the country creating the office for new Americans. But I think we have reasons to believe that Boston will again be a leader in the issue of the state ID. So that's hope there. In terms of the in-state tuition, it's really a shame that, you know, a legislature that is a Democratic legislature, you know, cannot pass in-state tuition when Florida just did it, and, you know, other many other states. And it's really, you know, what really happened to our wonderful Commonwealth of Massachusetts. A driver's license the other day was sent into study. You know, after having a wonderful, successful hearing. And it is, you know, the fight is not over. Massachusetts has taken lead in the country in many areas on immigrant integration. And the thing is, we need to work together, and the work is organized till we get things done.
It actually raises the question of the national issue of immigration reform, because the elections in the last, I didn't hear today's election results, but 2 weeks ago, where they're saying, the defeat of Eric Cantor is the end of immigration reform forever. I'd love to hear some comments on that.
I totally disagree with that. I think Cantor was not popular in his party, and I think he lost the election because he had no ability to lead and take a stand on immigration. He has never been a friend of immigrants, and he was one of the reasons why the bill never came to the floor for a vote. So I would say he lost because he was not popular, the party was not popular, and it was not because he supported immigration, it was because he had no ability to lead, take a stand, and do the right thing. Because, you know, he won as a supporter of immigration reform to the other candidate that was, you know, against immigration reform. So that's our view, and I think immigration reform is not dead. I think it's a matter of time. It's a matter of when. It's not a matter of if.
But I guess I would also just like to add that I think that the immigration reform proposals that that have been under discussion before the U.S. Congress in the last 10 years are so restrictive, so punitive, have so many negative aspects to them that it's, despite the fact that the immigration reforms are going to help some people, it's difficult to be against something that's going to help some people. I kind of feel like that cultural change has to happen that you were just talking about, Jose, before we can have a decent, dignified immigration reform. So I hesitate to say that our top goal should be pushing for one of these immigration reform bills that are currently politically possible.
I feel like immigrant rights is gonna go by the way of LGBT rights, meaning yeah. It's gonna go state by state. Like, we are now at the mercy of endless, never-ending political campaigns and the political football that happens in D.C. I was a political reporter, I know how this works. And so I feel like getting states to really take leadership, you know, on this issue. I mean, for me, so we've done 250 events in 45 states in 3 years. And driver's licenses to me is really interesting because it's the most tangible thing, right? Is there anything more American than driving? Driving and drive through eating, right? So like, I feel like once you explain to people to be undocumented means I can't drive, and you all know that I'm driving anyway. So why can't we talk about that, right?
I know you're working on giving your tax ID number so you can pay your taxes. I'm acknowledging that, but I'm not going to test you to get the driver.
We're going to start a really nice tax ID number information. Most Americans do not know what tax ID number is. The IRS doesn't care whether or not we're here legally. They only care if we pay taxes. There's so much we don't know.
Let's have a question here.
My name is Julia Kohler, and I actually wanted to talk about the driver's licenses because I completely agree that state by state something can change. And I would like to say that I know a lot of people who leave their house in the morning here in Boston or near Boston, in Medford, in Framingham, in Marlborough, in New Bedford, and they have to drive to work. There's no other way they can get to work. Or they have to drive to take their child to a clinic appointment, or to buy something that the family needs. And every time they get in the car, they are afraid that this is the time they're going to get arrested, and this is the time they're going to be turned over to ICE.
So what's up? Do we have a question coming here?
My question is, we have a lot of citizens in the audience, and what is lacking for our voters in Massachusetts to support their neighbors and co-workers and the people sitting beside them on the bus to call their legislators? Yesterday, three people voted for that bill, that's driver's license bill, in the legislature, and about a dozen acted against it. So what's missing here in Massachusetts among the people in this room and among our colleagues? Why aren't we doing anything about this?
What's it going to take?
It's going to take a lot of resources to organize in specific districts because, you know, our politicians need to understand that, you know, politics need to be left aside and the issue of the driver's license need to be solved. And you mentioned that, you know, it's an everyday need, but it's also a matter of safety. I mean, people are driving, they're driving without a license. So where is the responsibility? They representing everybody in this district, taking care of, you know, the safety of the Commonwealth. And it's not over yet. I mean, the bill will be refiled, but I think we need help. We need resources to organize. We need all the citizens. This is an issue of non-voters, you understand. They care about voters, they care about people in the district. So anything that you can do to make this issue of safety a priority and work together on this would be the answer to, you know, they feel the pressure of the in their district and they feel the pressure of their voters to deal with this issue.
No question over here. Okay.
My name is Sarah Tain, and I want to thank you for the incredible film. I have a question and then a comment. My question is, I think that too many people also tie in unconscious biases towards immigrants. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. There's this assumption that every immigrant is an illegal immigrant. So I'm just curious how you think you can try and tie that in, because I think there is a bigger issue here. Because when we talk about laws, let's not forget, folks, there was a time in this country where interracial marriages were forbidden. So I appreciate your comment that there is a bigger issue here about fighting for dignity. My question is this. What are you first? Are you a person first or an immigrant first? What are you first? Are you a person first or a woman or a man? You are a person first. And here's what I want to offer you too. My organization, World Unit Inc., has been dedicated to an extraordinary project for the last 20 years to build a landmark with this message. Are you greater than the sun that shines on everyone? Black, brown, yellow, red, and white, the sun does not discriminate. It shines on men and women, rich and poor, old and young, gay and straight, physically and mentally challenged, all religions, all of humanity. So my question to this wonderful city, why has it taken us 20 years so far to get this landmark done?
I don't know if we can answer
that. That's a lot of questions. So I think I'm a person first before I'm an immigrant first. We haven't even talked about Central America and the humanitarian crisis that is happening. And sometimes I feel it when I'm traveling the country, I feel like an open history book that no one has bothered to read. Which is that, you know, I wish that in this film I could have talked more about the remnants of colonialism and imperialism and what U.S. trade policies and economic policies have to do with migration patterns. That's a big issue. That's a whole other documentary. It's called The Harvest of Empire. It's really good. You should check that out, right? So, but your earlier question, which I think is a really rich question, is, so I'm Filipino, so we're the Italians of Asia. We have huge families. So out of 25 immediate cousins, relatives, aunts, I'm the only one of 25 who's undocumented. So I'm in a mixed status family. The irony here is when you talk to my family, they will tell you that Jose is actually the most American out of all of us. He's the one that got rid of his accent a lot sooner. He's the one that's like, can talk white and black at the same time when I'm reading this film. He's so, you know, like that's what they say about me. But what I find interesting about that is in this film, everything about this film is everything that I've been scared of, embarrassed about, and ashamed of since I was a kid. I used to hate the way my grandmother speak English because she spoke with a really big accent. And then, of course, it took me longer to realize how beautiful it was that she spoke the way that she spoke. So for me, like, putting that on screen, right? I don't think America is ready for this much Tagalog and some Spanish. What American television that's about to hit them. So embracing all of this to me is, like, really important. And embracing the complexity of all of this is really, really important. I feel like what's at stake with what you said is the American identity. We didn't call it defined immigrant. We call it defined American. Precisely for that reason. Right? And history, unfortunately, is not something that we talk a lot about.
No, we are not. Question up here.
So, I am from the Caribbean, and I have your book here, How Immigration Became Illegal. And I agree very much that we do need a cultural shift in terms of immigration, in terms of the way we look at immigrants. For instance, when I came here, I arrived, I was late, and I thought you were Hispanic. So the cultural shift I think we need is how immigration became Hispanic. Because there are thousands of undocumented immigrants who are Irish. There are thousands who are from the English-speaking Caribbean, and you know the demographics. They come from Haiti, they come from Eastern Europe, they come from all around the world, but whenever we refer to undocumented or illegal immigrant, we automatically think Hispanic. Mm-hmm. So part of the cultural shift has to move away from the fact that the only undocumented immigrants in this country are Hispanics. Yeah. And I think this is part of the reason as well that along the southern states and those Republicans are so anti-immigrant because they are so anti-Hispanic. and they are not thinking that there are Asians and other undocumented people in this country. So my question to you is, how do we begin to move the discussion away from the perception that only, you know, Latinos are undocumented?
Eva, do you obviously teach you referencing your work?
I mean, speaking from a historical point of view, I actually think that the category of undocumentedness was invented for Hispanics.
Somebody tweeting this, somebody tweeting this. Our handle is right at documented film. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
But once the laws were written and on the books, that is, they were designed with Mexican workers in mind. They were designed to look at migration, Western Hemisphere migration. And I don't want to talk for an hour going into the whole history of how immigration law was written, but undocumentedness, it wasn't until 1965 that numerical limits were put on Western Hemisphere migration. And programs like the Bracero program that brought in Mexican workers, guest workers, that is, undocumentedness was essentially invented in the 1960s as a way of continuing to exploit Mexican labor without calling it racially or nationally based. But once the category was invented and the laws were put into place, clearly lots of people who aren't Mexican workers, who aren't seasonal Mexican workers, like a lot of have fallen into the category. So I think it's both important to understand that what the questioner pointed out, that many people who are not Mexican are undocumented, and the category doesn't fit perfectly with the category Mexican, but also to understand the history of laws put into place to exploit Mexican labor and how undocumentedness fits into this history in its creation.
Folks, we're gonna have to stop here. I'm sorry, I see there are more questions. I'm sorry, I got told we were supposed to stop 2 minutes ago. Just a really short question, like one this long.
I have a question for Jose. So my best friend is an undocumented immigrant and he has a lot of dreams, and one of which is to study politics, and he wants to, maybe become a politician today, someday, or do international relations. And I try to motivate him and tell him, come on, if you want to reach that goal, you have to do internships, you have to do things, you have to volunteer. And what he says to me a lot of times is, Mark, what's my motivation? I don't have papers. There's no point. Even if I do internships, I can't do anything with my life. What do you suggest that I say to him to motivate him or make him feel better? Or, it makes me feel bad. I want to see him be successful in life.
Well, he's really lucky to have his friend, first thing. Second thing, tell him to go on YouTube and search for Gabby Pacheco, Eric Andiola, and all these undocumented youth who's been open leaders for a while. I guess for me, the biggest thing that I used to have to say to myself, and I say to young people all the time, is I just hope you don't say no to yourself. You cannot say no to yourself. Right? I don't know what I would have done if I didn't have you saw them in, all those allies, right? All those people in my life that didn't care, that didn't have papers. And that's why for us, it's really important that people like you speak out about this. It's important for people like you to know, for him to know that you're speaking out about something like this. Two last things. Please make sure that you check out the National Day to Stop Separating Families. House parties, official house parties, watch parties. Please go and we can send you Divine American swag for free. Parties. Actually, no, we have no more. Lara, can you stand up? One second. Lara, stand up. She helped plan
to stop you because obviously you all have a tremendous amount to say, and as does us. And I thank you very, very much. Avi,
thank you.